was heavy. I have to, because there's been tons of questions, but something I wanted to ask Kevin, since you brought it out and mentioned it probably in our Sabbath school hour, actually, people wanted a reference for the 1916 and the 1919 intervention, or the government coming down saying you need to change this message. Do you have references for that? Because people, this is the first time they've heard it, so they're just wanting
By the way,
okay,
you mentioned that in Sabbath school.
Yes.
Some people who are getting on now or who are on now did not
hear that. Probably have like 200 more that haven't heard that.
Okay. So you want me to do a quick recap?
Quick recap.
And then you can reference it.
So what Ivor and Atante are talking about is that during World War I, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, it was actually called just the Bureau of Investigation at the time. They took the name Federal Bureau of Investigation in the 1930s, but it's the same organization. They heavily targeted religious groups, and one of those groups that they targeted was the Seventh Adventist Church. And the reason that I've uncovered this, and it's something that historians had not known about before I uncovered it a couple of years ago, the reason I uncovered it is because one of my professors at Florida State University, where I'm doing my PhD, he's one of the very few who's really interested in the intersections between religion and surveillance. And so in taking class from him, I realized that this was becoming a thing among scholars right now. It's like, wow, that's interesting. And for my comprehensive examinations for my program, I read the book FBI and Religion. Okay, it came out a couple of years ago, edited by Sylvester Johnson and Stephen, starts with a W. Sorry, I'm going to drop that last name. And so I'm reading a chapter in there. It's on a black denomination, a black Pentecostal denomination called the Church of God in Christ. And as I'm reading that chapter, I see a sentence, one sentence, where this FBI agent is convinced that this black Pentecostal denomination, I mean, you can't get much lower than that, and they're also in the South. He says that they are not as dangerous as the Seventh-day Adventists. And I read that, and I'm just like, whoa, what are you saying here? And I looked up his source, and he had it there, and it's from a group of files called the Old German Files, and they are declassified now. And thankfully, they were not redacted, so none of the information is blotted out with black ink or whatever. And so those are online if you have a subscription. And I went online, and I started searching, and the searching is really, really bad because these things were originally typed on old typewriters. Mm-hmm. And so you search for the word Adventist and you only get like 32 hits. But I started filling in like all of the sorts of Adventist words, and I brought this up to over 2,500 pages of declassified FBI files on Seventh-day Adventists and well over 100 different case files. And I know that there are many, many, many more that it's going to be incredibly hard to find. We will never know the full extent of it because you look in Adventist archives and you see over and over and over and over again that the Federal Bureau of Investigation was convinced that our call porters and ministers were German spies.
Wow.
And so I started analyzing these documents that I found and realized that they are infiltrating our camp meetings secretly, our church services. They are confiscating our mail, intercepting our telegrams. They are holding missionaries who have been overseas and come back. They're holding them in jail for a period of time to investigate their cases. They do jail several of our call porters. They throw some of our Adventists who were conscientious objectors into an insane asylum. I mean, I could go on and on and on. And so they're doing this to us, and it comes to the point where they say, hey, we don't like what you're publishing. We believe you guys are socialists. Everything you're publishing is red. And so they said, basically, you need to change or you need to go to prison for a long time. And this was no idle threat. The group that we now call Jehovah's Witnesses, they existed at that time under a different name. Okay. And people throughout America regularly confused Seventh-day Adventists with the International Bible Student Association, what we now call Jehovah's Witnesses.
Uh-huh.
And the federal government goes to them, goes to their top leaders, they arrest them, for the same reasons that they're going to come hunting for us, and they prosecute them, and they sentence their top leaders to 80 years in prison to serve four consecutive terms of 20 years. So really, effectively, only 20 years in prison. But that's a long time. Mm. 4 days later, they come knocking at our door, and they say, look, are you in or out? Are you going to change what you published, or are you going to or go to prison? And Adventists decided to change. And so here's the really tough thing. This is major stuff for Adventist history. I found it a couple of years ago. I have written 2 or 3 different scholarly papers on the subject that I've presented and read in a boring scholarly kind of convention that nerds like Ben and I love to attend, and that's basically all. Okay, so I've done that. So I've done some preliminary analysis and work on this. However, I haven't published it yet because it takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. And you've got to do lots of other work to help contextualize and do lots of other things to get something like that published. But for those of you who want to know more about it right now, if you go to the Adventist Peace Fellowship website, I don't know exactly what the website is named, but you Google Adventist Peace Fellowship, you'll find it. And they have a podcast called Adventist Peace Radio. And so one of those papers that I have presented, I have recorded for them, and they've put it on a podcast, and you can get that information. So there really isn't a source, like a book or an article that I can give you. It doesn't exist. I haven't written it. No one else has written it. It's one of those things. There's many things like this in our history simply that we have forgotten and don't know. But there is a way to sort of get the information. And so go to that podcast and then check that out.
Mm-hmm. Kevin, yes. What did they change? Specifically
okay,
speaking.
Yes, I need to repeat that part of it for people who weren't here in the morning. So among the things that they change, and they change several things, like they go through and they cut out a lot of like condemnatory language that sounds unpatriotic. So anything that sounds anti 100% American, they're changing all of this kind of stuff. Anything that's critical of the United States of America. And Adventists were very critical of the United States. And one of the most ways that they were was this so-called doctrine of the two-horned beast, what they called the two-horned beast at that time. And most people know now as the lamb-like beast. And there are reasons you know it as the lamb-like beast, not the two-horned beast. And I'll get into that in a second. Make sure I don't drop it this time. I didn't mention this in Sabbath school.
Okay.
And so what we're doing is we're saying that America is this beast because it claims to protect religious liberty and civil liberty or social liberty. And so it looks like a lamb, but it speaks like a dragon because it denies religious liberty and civil liberty to religious and racial minorities. And so we're preaching this, we're teaching it, we're holding up pictures before people. And let me show you one, okay? Let me just show you what I'll have to take you to the door of my office, okay?
Let's go.
Does this show up? You see that two-horned beast there?
Yeah.
It's depicted. It's depicted as a lion with a lion head, a leopard's body, and the feet of a bear. Okay. And if anyone is a really good student of prophecy, they're going to say, "Hey, wait a second. That's how the beast from the sea in the first part of Revelation 13, that's how that beast is supposed to look."
Yeah.
You are indeed correct. Seventh-day Adventists are depicting the two-horned beast, the second beast that comes out of the earth in that chapter, because they believe that that beast is made in the image of the first beast. And what do Adventists say the first beast is?
Papacy.
Papacy. Mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm. And so they're claiming that Protestant America has become just as oppressive as the papacy was during the Middle Ages, okay? And that's why they're depicting this beast as a lion, leopard, bear combination. Okay, and so they are going to change all of this in World War I because the American government does not like being identified with this nasty beast. That seems so unpatriotic and so unacceptable. And as I mentioned
communist.
Before, this was a... Yeah, yeah, this is a time where First Amendment rights have never been tested and proven in courts, and so the government rode roughshod over all of the First Amendment rights, freedom of speech, freedom of religion. They coalesce very clearly in this moment for Adventist history. And so Adventists changed this. And so what they were doing before is they're saying America is this beast now. They're preaching this so thoroughly in the 19th century. America is currently this beast. It's oppressing people now. And starting in World War I, you see more and more frequently, and you see clearly in a book called Bible Readings from the Home Circle, where they say, no, America is not the two-horned beast now, but it will become so in the future mm-hmm. when it passes a national Sunday law. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And they also say it's not really America that will become the two-horned beast. It's just liberal Protestantism that's going to somehow take over the government and then become make America this two-horned beast. And so they shift things there. They shift the emphasis and focus. And what I didn't share in Sabbath school is that they shift in their depictions of the beast at the same time.
Hmm.
So whereas we're depicting it before as a leopard, lion, bear combination, gnarly looking thing, sometimes explicitly stating this is about creeds and slavery, all this kind of stuff, America's oppressing, we start to depict it as a benign buffalo. A cute little buffalo with two horns. Around the same time that the buffalo nickel comes out, for those of you who are aware of that, coin collecting and all of that. So America and the buffalo are becoming symbolic. Apparently they've forgotten everything they've done to the buffalo and Native Americans, you know, and they're trying to maybe overcome their past. So buffaloes are in around World War I. And Adventists start depicting this beast as not just an angry buffalo, but a cute buffalo. It looks nice. It looks like something you'd want to go visit at the zoo. And then shortly after that, around World War II, they shifted again, and then they just start depicting the thing as a cute little lamb. And at least they made it a little bit more biblically accurate this time, but nevertheless, they're not even putting a dragon forked tongue in that thing. They're not even saying that it speaks like a dragon. So they're domesticating. We domesticated our understanding of prophecy, not just in how we're saying it, but how we're also depicting it visually. And this is changing in World War I. And I'm not the first person to discover this. I'm connecting it with FBI surveillance of Adventism. And it wasn't just the FBI. There were other state institutions, the military, and other things that were also surveilling Adventism. And it was a very oppressive period of our history. I'm connecting that in there. But the first person to bring that up was Ronald Graybill. He wrote it in an article published in Insight magazine, which I believe is now defunct and has been defunct for a while. And then Douglas Morgan points that out too in his book, Adventism in the American Republic, which was published in 2001. And if you read Doug's book, Doug very briefly and like part of a paragraph mentions that at the 1919 Bible Conference, Seventh-day Adventist administrators were having to explain to pastors why had they changed Bible readings for the home circle? And so they explained to the ministers there that the Department of Justice, who oversaw the FBI, that they had come and said that they had to change things. So they actually admitted it, but only to a couple of dozen ministers that were there. I mean, most people never knew this.
Yeah.
You look at other Adventist tracts, and they will say in books, they'll say that this past the chief military censor on a certain day. So they actually owned up to the fact that they revised their stuff.
Yeah.
They never did that for Bible readings for the home circle.
Yeah.
They never did it when it came to changing our actual doctrine, part of our fundamental beliefs, part of the three angels' message.
So
they didn't accept that. They didn't own up to that.
So what happens from that point forward is we're hearing less and less about this beast currently speaking like a dragon. Its future, that provides the platform for an increase in patriotism.
Oh man, and it happened. Oh, it happened. Take a look at our history. You're going to find hardly any books on Seventh-day Adventist involvement in the Civil War, even though there were soldiers there, or World War I. Next to nothing is written on that. You go to World War II, huge explosion. We're writing book after book after book saying how awesomely patriotic Adventists were. Whereas our non-combatant stance that we took officially as a church had been a reluctant thing that you did only if you were drafted because you didn't want to take a bullet and become a martyr for your pacifism. That was a reluctant stopgap measure. By the time of World War II, we have made non-combatancy the way that we are patriotic. And we hold up Desmond Doss as this amazing, awesome hero in the church. I'm not denying that what he did was amazing. I don't want to bash his legacy.
Right.
But what I'm saying is it's emblematic of a shift where Adventists in America are no longer looking at America as an oppressive beast because of what it does to religious and ethnic and racial minorities. They're upholding it with such firm patriotism. So much so that shortly after, and this is something most people may not know either, shortly after World War II, the Army and the federal government is so impressed, by and large, through people like Desmond Doss, who became a huge national hero, the first Adventist to, and first conscientious objector to get the Medal of Honor, highest mm-hmm. medal that you can achieve. Because of this publicity, they come knocking at our door and say, hey, now there's this thing called the Cold War going on, and biological and chemical warfare is a big problem. We're really worried about Russia dropping some sort of chemical bomb on America and hurting us. And so they said, how about this? How about we give you Sabbath privileges and non-combatant roles, and you come in and you serve as what we call white coats for a project we call Operation White Coat. So what we'll do to you, we'll tell you what we're going to do first, but we're going to give you, we're going to inject biological chemicals into your body, see how you react so that we can try to find an antidote for it. And so they made Adventists in almost all of the white coats, like over 3,000 of them, almost all of them were Adventists.
Wow.
And so they pump them with these chemicals and stuff, or give them something to breathe, like the West Nile fly virus or whatever. And then they try to see how they'll behave, how they'll react, and then they try to come up with a vaccine. So they made Adventists human test subjects. Mm. And Adventists were very proud to do this. Mm. And I'm not trying to say they were wrong or whatever. I'm just saying this is what happens. And so it was a way to be patriotic, to support our nation. And yeah, there's some good that happened. A lot of the vaccines we have for major things like hepatitis A, hepatitis B, typhoid, several things, it come from this, guys.
Yeah.
Adventists were also responsible for putting us on the moon, because they were not going to send astronauts to space unless they knew that they could work, that they could navigate that space shuttle under the absolute worst conditions possible. Mm. So they pumped, they trained Adventists how to operate a space shuttle. They went through the flight simulator and they pumped them full with all these horrible diseases, so much so that like the panel lights underneath the buttons in the space shuttle burned their eyes, like it was blinding their eyes.
Wow.
But nevertheless, Adventists were able to navigate that thing in simulation mode back to Earth, that they said, okay, we'll send our astronauts now to space. And so they do.
Wow.
And bringing this back to black people, by the way, Ben can tell you about the Adventist inventor who worked for NASA who was black.
Mm.
What's his name, Ben? I'm dropping it right now. Oh, well, that's an aside. But he was an awesome guy. But he... Speaking of racism in America, he invented so many things, like the tires that they use on the moon rovers. He invented a toilet that could be used in weightless conditions, and he never got patent rights for these things.
Mm.
Wow.
Everyone else for NASA is patenting things, and he never got credit for any of the inventions he made until historians later found out, oh my word, Robert Cherney, right? Yeah, Robert Cherney.
Wow.
Oh wow, he invented it. That was an aside, but
yeah.
If I can just say something real quickly, Kevin, that with this rise of Adventist patriotism that you very eloquently just spoke on, this was one of the reasons why Adventists didn't want to be associated with the civil rights movement.
Oh yeah,
definitely.
Wow,
definitely. Colin
Kaepernick. Fear of communism.
Colin Kaepernick. Was when he was kneeling, he was seen as anti-patriotic, as not being. Of course, this was debunked because people were pointing out that patriotism and protest is quintessentially American and quintessentially patriotic. So that's been debunked. But Adventists were distancing themselves from the civil rights movement because some believed that. The sort of protest that they were doing, Martin Luther King and others, that it was not American enough.
The peaceful protests.
Yes, Adventists were still trying to prove their patriotism to the American government while also trying to prove their Christianity to evangelicals. So we were just doing a lot of proving during that time. But you still see it now that there's this stigma against the racial protest, the anti-racism protests, because it's perceived as not being American enough.
Mm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm. And so the Adventists, because of this real patriotic jag that they were going on, you know, since World War I and before, they wanted to distance themselves from the civil rights movement.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of the FBI and religion, Ben, to piggyback off of you, piggyback off of me, Speaking of FBI and religion, most people do not realize that Martin Luther King was put on the FBI's top 10 most wanted list.
Yeah, I did know that.
And they did that because they were convinced that he and everyone else in the civil rights movement were communists. And of course, this is during the Red Scare, the Cold War. Mm. And so to be quote unquote red was the most un-American thing you could possibly be. And this was entire poppycock. Mm. Okay. But nevertheless, some of these people had attended at one point in time, maybe a socialist meeting or a communist meeting. And so just for the very fact that they were there and maybe got a picture taken there, they're like, oh, they're all red. And so the FBI put MLK on the top 10 most wanted list. And it gets even worse. So this another thing that bothers me now is that so many Adventists, white Americans generally, are throwing down stuff like, what, MLK? Yeah, but why hold him up like such a great guy when he was, you know, having all of these affairs?
Right. And that's what they kind of taught. I mean, sorry to interrupt you, but that's what we were made to believe, why, you know, the FBI was trying to find things on him.
Yeah.
You know, so
you want to know why we know that? You want to know why we know that information about MLK? It's not illegal in the 20th century to be having an affair.
Mm. Right.
The FBI had no legal right to be wiretapping his hotel room
right.
when he's doing this. And I'm not excusing the fact that he had affairs.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
They knew that they had no legal right for this. But you know what? They leaked the wiretapped recordings. And you know why they leaked the wiretapped recordings? Because Martin Luther King Jr. had been nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize and white Americans did not want him to receive it.
Mm.
And so they mailed a copy of that to his wife and then they leaked it to the press
mm.
because they did not want him to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. Now, I'm grateful that King got it anyways.
Mm-hmm.
But nevertheless, that's why we even know that. And mm. it wasn't an illegal thing. I'm not excusing it.
Yeah.
But just for the fact that he made mistakes, that doesn't mean he didn't do some really, really importantly awesome and wonderful things. Mm-hmm. And so mm-hmm. I hope that people understand that kind of history, because it does put a different light on the way that King was treated.
Right.
He was incredibly, incredibly abused by the federal government, by white Americans, North and South. I mean, it's just amazing. And, he's not alone. Not alone.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So basically, when we began to care more about what other people think, so we're trying to please America. Hey, look, we're trying to please the evangelicals. Hey, look, we forgot about our message and basically created a vacuum mm-hmm. that now when the message is preached, when the message is lived, it seems so like, is this new? Is yeah, this like, new theology? Like, is this right? Like, is this the movement going off the rails? Mm-hmm. We're supposed to be preaching the three angels' messages. What in the world is going on? Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty.
Yeah, and this is why most people, almost everybody, including some of our Adventist historians, this is entirely new information for them.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know about the extent of the abolitionism before the Civil War. They didn't know that we were targeted by the FBI. They didn't know any of that kind of stuff. And you start to put all of these things together. I mean, there's so much that was known, but nevertheless, this is new to most people because we've always assumed, just like religions tend to do, the religions don't change. We've always been true to our heritage, always been true to our past. We've always been preaching the same message, same three angels message. We have not, folks. We have not. Before the Civil War, you could not preach the three angels message and not condemn slavery and the injustice we treated to blacks.
Wow.
You couldn't. And no one did. There's not a single shred of evidence that they ever divorced it. I mean, you can look at Adventist sources. You can also look at non-Adventist sources in newspapers where Americans are hearing this information coming from that, and they don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't like it. And so they attack Adventists in the press before the Civil War. It did happen.
Mm.
And it was so virulent that this is another important point that I haven't shared yet. When Adventists are doing this, talking about politics, we tend to distinguish between preaching and teaching religion and politics. They're not always seen as separate things. And really, it's really hard to divorce them because when Adventists are doing this, it becomes illegal in the South for Adventists to mail their literature down there. Now, why is that so?
Wow.
After Nat Turner's Rebellion in 1831 and a few other things go down in the South, it becomes illegal to send abolitionist material through the post office.
Wow.
And what happens in the late 1850s is that Seventh-day Adventists were saying so much against slavery that the Southern post offices are not just withholding and saying this is illegal, they're throwing all of our mail away, and James White says it was impossible to send any of our literature to the South. We actually had a few ministers that went to some of the border states like Missouri and Kentucky, and they were threatened with imprisonment and like $3,000 fine. And $3,000 in 1859, folks, that is a lot of money. That's probably well over a year's wages, okay? And so they're threatening our ministers in every kind of way because of the fact that they recognize we are abolitionists. And so that's a political thing, guys. Preaching and teaching the word, people can, and the state has. Over again in our past history, they have seen our preaching as political.
Wow.
And so I don't, we don't need to debate whatever the nuts, I don't care what you call it. Like Ben said, call it a tomato. Okay.
But you know, it's what I'm just like, oh, wow. Like this is Satan's way to water down our message.
Yes.
So the more, oh, that's political. Oh, that's political. You stop saying that because, you know, man, that is just...
It creates a mask.
Yeah.
It creates a mask. Just like there's all these arguments about, you know, like the colorblind racist. I don't see color. You know, a lot of white people say, I don't see color. I'm not racist. I don't see color. That is a mask for their racism. What you're saying in those statements is that black people aren't beautiful. That looking at their blackness is somehow a thing that you should ignore and that you can't accept it. I mean, there is so much, and we always, like, we do, this is Satan's work. This is Satan's work. We just, we create some sort of label, and we say, oh, we can't do that. And it's just a mask for our racism, a mask for the devil's own agenda. You're right when you say that. Absolutely, Pastor Myers. I think you're dead on when you say that.
We talked about this, too.